Hi everyone. Hope you are enjoying the snow day. Don't want to make you work too hard. hopefully you're enjoying yourselves over the course of the weekend. But I thought this lecture, this sort of mini video, would help sort of tie up some of the loose ends and give us a plausible deniability just in case someone asks why we weren't in class on Friday. So before I do that, I want to jump into the big narratives of the course and hopefully you'll understand why I feel like this lecture is pretty important. The big development that we've been talking about is the development of this sort of new model of the state. A uniform territorial state under a unified government, under a powerful government, usually a monarch. And I argued that a lot of this is sort of tied to some of the materialistic narratives that we've been talking about. The gunpowder revolution, to be sure, the demographic effects of the Black Plague, the economic effects of world trade because of the age of exploration, and so on and so forth. There's one other big materialistic change going on at this point that I didn't get a chance to talk about before, but I have to just because it's so awesome and so interesting, I think. The biological changes that come about because of the interchange between the New World and the Old World. We talk about smallpox and the effect on the native populations, and that is certainly a big part of it. But eventually, we see biological interchange in terms of animals and in terms of foodstuffs. And if you have a greater diversity of agricultural products, then you have a stronger diet and you have a greater possibility of survival. So believe it or not, in the wake of this biological exchange, this Columbian exchange, Europe sees this unbelievable demographic takeoff. So if you remember way back that I talked about the sort of possible cap on population in Europe, that somehow it never seems to get above about that 75 million that we saw in ancient Rome and then in the 14th century. Well, over the course of the centuries that we're talking about, the population just absolutely blows through that ceiling. It goes to 100 million, then 200 million, then 400 million, and only now is it finally leveling off just short of 800 million. So the modern era in Europe is one of remarkable demographic improvement. All right, so we have all of these material changes that we've been talking about, but we also have the idealistic changes that we've been talking about, the Renaissance, the Reformation, the Scientific Revolution. And these sort of continue into the great intellectual movement of the 18th century, which is the Enlightenment. Now, the term Enlightenment is debated on and on. You know, when does it start? Who counts as an Enlightenment figure? For us, it doesn't matter. What does matter is the connection that we see between the Enlightenment and the narratives that we've been talking about before, in particular the scientific revolution. And this is why I was harping so much on the debate between Pascal and Descartes, and then the connection to Thomas Hobbes, and to eventually to John Locke, the major philosophical conundrum that they're sort of dealing with. If what we're doing in all of these intellectual revolutions is that we're overhauling or overthrowing the pre-existing authority, what do we do? What's left? So should we go the Pascal route and bracket off certain topics and say, well, in religion we're going to keep authority, and in science we're going to maybe turn it over a little bit? Or do you go the Descartes route and you say, blow it all up, start from nothing? And that's the kind of question that Thomas Hobbes is trying to deal with and trying to articulate a politics that starts from the most basic level after you've thrown away all received authority. All right, so this is a question that starts in science, but it becomes a philosophical question with implications for politics, for religion, and all sorts of other areas. So you can follow through on the slides and see some of the figures that I'm going to talk about and how these sort of narratives start to change. So Pascal and Descartes both had ideas about the implications of scientific discovery for religion. What does it mean for religious belief? Well, we have one philosopher who sort of takes the ball and runs with it and says, all right, well, if Pascal's right, and there should be this sort of separation between what we know from religion and what we know from science. Well, if there's no rational basis for our religious beliefs, if they obey different rules, don't we sort of have to support religious toleration? Science is obvious. We should be able to agree on science, he says. But if religion comes about because of inspiration, because God has touched us on the shoulder, how are we supposed to punish those who don't have that same sort of divine inspiration that we do? So Pierre Bayle, who you see in that slide there, is one of the first figures to articulate religious separation as a necessary good rather than just as sort of a way of preserving the civil peace. other people take that sort of question and say, well, maybe religion and science should be in the same vein. We should apply the same standards of proof to religion that we have applied to science. So some of you may know Thomas Paine is one of the great pamphleteers of the American Revolution. Well, he also wrote a text called The Age of Reason, and he turns his scientific logic to the story of the New Testament. He says, you know, how do we actually know what we think we know about Jesus of Nazareth? The resurrection of Jesus, the supposed great miracle, should have been apparent to all of Jerusalem. But the only way we know it is because of the words of a half dozen or so apostles. So Paine turns this sort of on his head, doesn't say, you know, we must not believe in God, but rather we don't have to believe in God, that the standards of proof just are not quite the same as they are for science. So wherever people fall on this spectrum, there's an increasing agreement that there are certain sides of religion that don't follow rational ideas in the same way as others do. So witchcraft trials go by the wayside. Miracles maybe get de-emphasized in the Catholic tradition. Even if you are a believer, there's more of a sense that your religion needs to follow at least some of the rules of rational, organized reason, let's say. All right. So, in the same way, this new thinking causes a rethinking in politics. We saw that with Hobbes and Locke. That was the sort of big argument that I was making at the end of class yesterday. you could consider them both figures of the early Enlightenment, trying to figure out a rational basis for politics. But in the 18th century, these questions come more and more to the fore. How do we organize a society that will best provide for its members? What is a state supposed to provide? And does our existing social order, our existing political order, actually do what it's supposed to do? Now, you have to tread carefully when you're doing this because you don't want to anger the civil authorities, but there are certain ways around it. So Montesquieu, who we read for yesterday, is a great example of this. Yes, he wrote Persian Letters, and yes, that's terrific work, but he's most famous probably for this work that he puts together. He titles it, you know, on the particular types of governments and what how they are derived from the societies in which they're based. And if you read the work, it's really interesting because he surveys the different governmental systems in different countries, and it's pretty clear that he prefers the English mode, the one that came about as a result of the Glorious Revolution. But he can't advocate for that for France. He can't advocate for revolution to keep the king in his place. So he has to say, France is fine with absolute monarchy. Absolute monarchy is great for France. But hey, limited monarchy really works for England. Of course, in France it would never work. But it's pretty great for England, right? So reading between the lines, you can certainly see where Montesquieu's sympathies are. And what Montesquieu is arguing is that in England, the institutions are set up to check each other. So the lower classes and the elites of society have institutions to check each other. The center and the localities have ways of checking each other's authority. So he's one of the first people to really advocate for a divided vision of government, divided sovereignty. if you think about it, there's actually a nice connection to ancient Rome. The Senate checks the power of the dictators, the plebeians check the power of the patricians, and so on and so forth. It's a great way of connecting really our whole course together. All right, so all these political and social questions are in the air. But the weird part is that even as monarchy is being questioned, these ideas are coming about at a time when monarchy is becoming more and more absolute. And for a time, there's this sense that, well, maybe this new thinking can coexist with absolute monarchy. Or maybe they don't even need to coexist. They can actually help serve each other. So in the middle to late portions of the 18th century, we see this new sort of ideology for monarchy. It shares some of the tendencies of absolutism that I talked about yesterday, but it also embraces the new thinking of the Enlightenment. So it comes to be known as enlightened despotism or enlightened absolutism. So it takes absolutism and marries it to an appreciation for the Enlightenment. These two trends can actually serve each other. So the idea is that the policies that the absolute monarch imposes have to accord with Enlightenment ideals. They have to be rational. They have to be orderly. They have to be based on reason rather than tradition. But on the other hand, only one person seeing the whole picture can really make a single rational orderly system. So that's why absolutism is necessary. So for an absolute monarch to really work in an enlightened fashion, they have a great responsibility. They have to be current with the arts and sciences and politics and philosophy and all of the thinking of the day. But there are a handful of them who actually achieve something kind of like that. So to finish off, I want to talk about the two most famous figures in enlightened despotism. The two great figures both get this title, the Great, by their followers. But bear in mind, there are lots of other areas where monarchs are trying to engage in these sorts of practices. The kings of Sweden, the kings of Poland, even hardcore Catholic areas like Spain or Austria, the monarchs are trying a more rational, more reason-based schema for their rule. All right, Frederick the Great, who you see there, is probably the monarch most associated with the idea of enlightened despotism. He's the king of Prussia. Prussia, you remember, is this extant banning territory within the Holy Roman Empire. It will eventually become the basis for the Germany that we know today. Now, Frederick is raised in this sort of Prussian tradition of the great military and the powerful military projecting its forces and so on. And Frederick's father wanted him to be a military commander in this tradition and raised him very strictly. But temperamentally, Frederick was very different. He had the soul of a poet. He admired French culture. His friends were intellectuals and idealists. Actually, right about the time that he takes over power, he authors a text called the Anti-Machiavel. And in this text, he argues against Machiavelli's The Prince. He argues that a prince should not care about keeping power. He should care about what is best for his society. The great Enlightenment thinker Voltaire is actually probably his co-author on this text. Voltaire was not exactly popular in France because he was very critical of the monarchy, but in Frederick's Prussia, he was a welcome figure. All right, so as it turned out, Frederick was able to balance both sides of his upbringing, the strict side that he got from his father and the more cultured side that he saw from, that he admired from all sorts of other sources. So when he takes over as king, he sets up the Berlin Academy as a new center of learning. Berlin becomes a major intellectual center. Frederick himself is a major cultural figure. He composes music for the flute. He writes poetry. He writes drama. He writes history. And he tries to organize his regime in a more rational, coherent, orderly fashion. And even though his father never would have guessed it, when Frederick finally does take the throne, he's a remarkable military commander in his own right. So he's one of the dominant political figures of the middle of the 18th century. The other figure who takes over midway through Frederick's reign in a different region of Europe, I'm being biased here, I'm finishing off with Russia, but Catherine is such a great figure, how can I not? Okay, so if you look at those pictures, you see Catherine the Great, who reigned over Russia for 34 years. And I have a few examples from Catherine that just sort of continue that narrative that I was developing the other day with absolutism, that even as rulers are trying to put forward a rational basis for their rule, at the same time, they're still using some of those old modes to sort of represent themselves. So you see Catherine representing herself as Athena, the goddess of wisdom. So on the one hand, she's like Louis or like Peter the Great because she's representing herself as a goddess. But she's doing it by emphasizing wisdom and learning and rationality. So she's an enlightened despot as well. All right. So Catherine is very current with the new thinking in politics that is going on, and she works to bring enlightenment approaches to Russia. So shortly after she takes over, Catherine convenes what she calls a legislative commission. It's not entirely sure what she had in mind because this legislative commission has to disband because there's a war. But Catherine writes this instruction to an assembly that she tries to bring together. And it is pretty revealing for what it reveals about Catherine's approach to rule. She borrows from Enlightenment thinkers, Montesquieu in particular, and she tries to synthesize Enlightenment thinking about politics with absolutist monarchy. So in this document, where she's giving instructions to her nobility, she's saying, well, absolute monarchy is the best government for Russia. It's a great, big, vast realm. Only absolute monarchy can work for it. And she says, you know, it is better to obey the laws under the direction of one master than to be subject to the wills of many. So in other words, monarchy is better than, you know, anarchy because too many people have too much power. So she's sort of getting at this tension at the heart of the Enlightenment and the Enlightenment political project. She wants absolute monarchy, but she wants a state that is governed by laws. Well, that's a contradiction in terms here, right? Who is supreme, the monarch or the laws? So this is a question or a tension that hangs over a lot of Catherine's reign. For much of the time, she seems like, you know, she's totally fine with the managing the tensions between two ideas. And like Frederick, she's active in all sorts of areas. She's a sponsor of immigration. She brings in all sorts of Germans and other migrants who have skills that would be useful for Russia. She sponsors education for girls as well as for boys. She overhauls her administration. She tries to make St. Petersburg a great cultural center like Frederick's Berlin. So she sponsors a theater company. She sends collectors all over Europe to buy up paintings for her art collection. She gets 4,000 paintings from the old masters. And the last couple of slides here are me acting as a Russian tour guide just one more time. It's this collection that turns into the Hermitage Museum, which is next to the Louvre as like the greatest museum in the world. So whatever you do, find time in your life, get over to St. Petersburg and see the palace there and the art exhibition. It's absolutely amazing. Okay, so like Frederick the Great, Catherine is engaging in correspondence with a lot of the leading figures of the Enlightenment. So just like Frederick, she's writing letters back and forth with Voltaire. She never met him personally. She invited him to come to Petersburg. She'd love to see him. He kept putting her off and putting her off and putting her off. And I have been to St. Petersburg in the winter. Voltaire may have had the right idea. Catherine did get another famous figure to come, a guy by the name of Denis Diderot. And Diderot is the famous as the co-creator of the first great encyclopedia. This encyclopedia is a massive tome, 27 volumes. It's sort of a perfect embodiment of the Enlightenment, the idea that we can put all human knowledge in rational, coherent order in a single collection of volumes. Anyway, so this is what makes Diderot famous. He gets an invitation from Catherine, and he comes to St. Petersburg. And apparently the trip went fairly well. They're engaged in conversation for hours at a time. Catherine was amused and, you know, enthralled by all of his different ideas, but she was also shrewd enough to keep him at arm's length. He was a great conversation partner, she said, but not a real political advisor. And later on, she said, well, his conversation had more curiosity than profit. There's a famous story that gets told is that there's one point when he's telling her sort of an outlandish proposal that sounds great but kind of utopian, and she's just sort of laughing and, you know, patting him on the arm and all of the rest. But then she says, well, your ideas may work well on paper, but I have to write on human skin, which does not take the ink quite so well. So that interaction sort of foreshadows the notion that ultimately there cannot be a true union between the intellectual movement of the time period and the politics of the time period. And so when that union breaks between intellectual movements and between the politics, when that union breaks, all hell will break loose. And if you want to know more about that, there is a wonderful class in the spring semester that has a few more registration slots that are still available. Until then, it has been an absolute pleasure. Stay warm out there, and I will see you soon. Bye-bye.